Thanks for attending these sessions. We will start now. So, yeah, please take a seat. So, if you choose the room right, you're in the room where we will learn about some best practices to build an API relationships between authorization server and APIs. So, meaning that it's best if you have like some basic knowledge about like OAuth, OpenID, and all that stuff, but be safe, we're gonna go through and do some refresh as well at the beginning. So first, I'm Vincent Senut, I'm solution engineer. I work at Okta as a specialist around identity, customers, internal, and I like to do speech like this one and talk about how we want to secure access to identity, because that's the core business of Okta, which is like kind of large, because when you think about identities, it's basically very transversal, it touches anything. Today, we're gonna really focus on API and the way we authorize access to API, but we work on a company where we really manage all kinds of technologies and manage access to all of that technologies. So the menu for today will be, as I say, like a quick introduction and refresh about like what is authorization server, what is API. So some refresh as well as those protocols, as OpenID and O2, which is kind of important for the topic of today, and some challenge that I've like picked up where we're gonna discuss. This challenge is more like things that we saw on the field, like that was sometimes like debates around or like a pitfall we try to avoid. Of course, there is more than those on the screen. Feel free to ask more questions at the end if you have like a specific challenge you want to discuss or address or at the booth after. But they're all on the screen. And at the end, I will leave you with some homeworks if you like what you saw. It's going to be some kind of labs, but of course, we're not going to do it right now, but you will be free to do it after. And of course, discuss it at the booth. So, the protagonist of today is authorization servers and API. So why those two exist? They exist because we need security when we build API, and this is all about it. We want to develop securely in the API economy, where before we had the use to develop API more privately for internal uses. Now it has to be reused, it has to be exposed, it has to be many things, so we know about it. So all authorization servers are common in the pictures, no. We saw it everywhere. And what I want today is just to make like a little refresh about how they work together. So, have some fun examples just to make sure that we're all on the same page. An authorization server is someone that likes securities. So, if you know Dwight Schrute, for instance, he's the guy that loves applying standards, loves securities. And we have like some minions that really are agile, practical, but we want to control to who they speak, which data they give, and for that, we're gonna control it with access token that we deliver with the authorization server. So this is all about needing securities. And these securities, we want to make it with tokens because they are like non-statical credentials. They have like a lot of standards around to secure the access. And they're very practical for the security teams because they can control all the APIs, see what's happening, authorize access. And for API, it's kind of convenient because they need security, but security is complex and it's kind of easy to just trust a token, validate a token, and you're good to go. Of course, there may be some more stuff to do, but basically, that's where we want to start. Validate that the token is valid, in the case a banana, and give access to the data. So, if you miss or you misunderstand some stuff, some recommendations, we have like a nice video about an illustrated guide on both protocols, which use like a website that give like terrible pun of the days. That's like the example in that video. That's kind of a spoil. But yeah, feel free to access it and you will get more like information. So, just a question first. Who knows about the basics of OIDC and OAuth in the room? Like everyone, mostly? Okay, all right. So for those that don't know, I will still do a quick refresh since we're there. Basically, the idea is any users want to access an app which has data, which has API and resources and so on. And the way we're going to build the architectures is we're going to ask our authorization server that applies some security at the edge directly. So meaning that as soon as I want to do something authenticated on my app, native web browsers, I'm being redirected or I'm being using an authorization server to authenticate myself. So this authentication is part of what can do an authorization server. So you hear about customer identity, identity as a service. Most of them, they have like the authorization server part. And they give you the authentication part as well. So on this example, you can do like some basic credentials, or it can be multi-factor authentications, or passkeys. But this is another topic, hot topic of and a trendy topic, so we can talk about it as well later. But let's say that you can use your passkeys to access your apps and then after your APIs. Because at the end, your apps will act as yourself to talk to APIs. And because it will act as yourself, it will be delegated. We will delegate a code, a tokens, and this code will allow me or allow my apps to get this access tokens, the banana that I need to talk to my APIs. And this access token is signed, delivered by my authorization servers, and I will entrust my app to use it. So basically, that's what does my app to get this token. She call an API endpoint and get the tokens to do the talk. So at the end of the days, I get those tokens and those bananas given to my app, and we can talk to the APIs quite easily. And the APIs will trust the access token because we have established the trust before. The way it has been established, it's like cryptographic, it's a crypto. So basically, you have like public keys that will be known by the APIs that will validate the access token that will be presented to them. And then you can access the data on the API. To go more on deep dive, we talk about token, access token, the way we deliver them, authenticate and access and API and so on. But what is a token? Basically, a token is a JWT, a JWT. And inside, you will find like claims and attributes that are very practical for my API because it will be used to validate who is the identity, who is the users that needs to get data. And some other important information, such as, for instance, scope, or such as, like, I don't know, expirations, and all information that came from my authorization server. So why we're having this talk today is because on the paper, it looks like a postal card. It's really magical because we really speak. Everyone, I think, here say that use authorization server, use O2, do security, your API is going to be IP, authorization server too. But there is many, many standards. This is a very complex protocols apart from what we see here. It helps with security, but it brings many questions. And it evolves all the times. The way that if you continue really untrusting your authorization server to give access to your to authorize access to your API, you will face times where even Dwight Schrute might not be able to face all the challenge, even if this is what we want to do at the beginning. So this way, I give some example of what we can, for instance, encounter. API may need more than just like a classic token to get data back. They want like more information about, for instance, John being able to access the expense of Remy. But for that, they need more authorizations, more information about the authorizations. The thing is, an authorization server does only, for instance, basic scopes such as you can view expenses, you can read, you can access this, that, but they don't give precise information about what permission do you really have on the app, because this is not the role. And sometimes there could be quiproquo on the API and the authorization server. We could have situations where we want to do machine-to-machine tokens, but yeah, sure, we can give you one, but the API, we Trust API to do like all the best practices about using token, validating access, but they're not always doing it, and we need to control. And sometimes you have like a new certification, new standards coming into play, and all these standards brings complexity that you need to manage. And sometimes this is even standards that nobody knows about, and the authorization server just can't answer. So we have to face all of that. And I think first, to be sure that API and authorization servers can safely exchange token, authorize user to access data, we need to get access token the right way. And that's the first step, the first challenge. Because it could be easy, most of the framework and solutions will guide you, will tell you what to do. But it's very important that you understand what you have, what you've been proposed to get those tokens so you can give access to your APIs. Those tokens, they're being delivered to an app by many different ways because there is many canals. There is public app. Public app is running on your smartphone. Public app is running as a single page application on your web browsers. And they get tokens, which are like privileged tokens to access your data. So we need to ensure security. It could be like smart TV, it could be machine to machine. And for all of these use cases, you have a specific OAuth grant type flow. So this schema here gives you like a tree choice about what you need to choose. It used to be much larger before, because now we are running on OAuth 2.1. for most of the best practices, meaning that by the past, you may have heard about implicit grant, ROPC, resource owner password, authorization cone without the extensions called PIXI, and all of these grant types are not recommended at all today. So this is completely things that authorization servers don't like. So that's why I have like Dwight screaming here, because we want to avoid that. And to avoid that, we want to build and plan our APIs and our applications to use new grant types. And to use new grant types, you need like frameworks, SDKs that are up to date, actively maintained, and everything. So I think that's the key here. So be careful of that. That's really the first pitfall when you start building apps or API. Once you get the token, because here it was about getting the token right, with the right grant type, grant flow, meaning that the authorization server deliver me the token securely. Once I got it on my API, then I need to validate these tokens. So the way you build your API before, we used to, validate stuff on the database, do inline authorizations or whatever. So now we got these tokens and we need to securely validate this. The best way is still to use what you have in your middleware or your framework. So if you use .NET, use what is provided by default on .NET. It's going to be maintained, actively maintained, supported, patch. You will avoid some vuln. There will be best practices and documentation around. If you're running on a more like exotic language, some don't have like support for that, then you will need like third-party libraries. And then you will end up looking at GitHubs or plugins, and there's going to be tons of them. The only keys is it actively maintained and well documented, really? Because actively maintained means, of course, for security reasons, many reasons that you will not have pitfall in terms of security, but as well, because you will not end up having like an unsupported library that is end of life and redevelop everything. And we've seen that like many times on our discussions with some of our customers having to redevelop or ask us about what they should use because they have issues. So yeah, choose well. And most of the times as well, your authorization server can help and give you SDKs and give you stuff that are maintained. Last one, if you feel like very like inspired to do manually the checks, because sometimes we like to, for better understanding how it works, do it manually. You can do it for to learn or for learning purpose. But in general, just don't do it. Because again, you will end up spending so much time trying to do all the security checks that is required. To give you an idea, when you need to check all the security aspect of a tokens, you need to retrieve and parse the keys that can validate the signatures. And these keys change, so you need to retrieve periodically, manage cache. Then you need to decode the access token, which is encoded in most of the times base 64. Then you need to verify these signatures. Then you need to parse the claims, check all the claims, validate all the claims. This is a full-time work just to implement something that works well and that is secure. So that's why it's always best to use like what you have already on your framework. So we get the token, we validate the tokens. That's nice. It looks like we are good to go for like a nice delivery of a new project and a new API. But you discover that the app that's going to be published is a single page app. So in that case, there is new challenge coming in. Single page are by definition public applications. And public applications will store the tokens on a public web browser, meaning that the users or anyone can possibly access the token, or there will be risk that this token leaks, I don't know, get used by something else, because it happened on the end user side and we don't control anything. So it's a risk, and we want to have access tokens that have like a little time to live in this case. So if this is stolen by someone or something, at least it will expire, and you know it's gonna mitigate or limit the threat. But you have like all the people from marketing or other developers that say, no, we need end user experiences. We need to give people 10-hour sessions to continue browsing safely. So how do you do that then? Because you need to call your back. And if you have a 10-hour sessions, the tokens will not stand for 10 hours. So you need long-lived tokens. So that's the first thing we did. It's not an issue. Let's go to the authorization server. Let's go to the rules, go to the access tokens, put 10 hours, and we're good to go. But leaving access tokens for 10 hours is a very high risk because it can get stolen. And then for 10 hours, someone can do anything, replay, reuse, access your API. So please, don't do it. That's not something you want. So instead, what the standards planned, and it's part of the RFC of OAuth, is to use refresh tokens. Refresh tokens, it will basically allow me to renew my access token, even if I don't have like a constant re-authentication of users. So it can stand like 10 hours, the user sessions, but I can still get tokens and they will be 15-minute expirations. But then you say, yeah, but refresh tokens, this is the same story. If someone stole these refresh tokens, then he can do anything, right? So the standards came up with like a concept, let's say that is a good compromise, which is token rotations. Token rotations bring the idea of the one-time use refresh token. So you give a refresh tokens, so your app, after 15 minutes, can ask for a new access token, but it automatically revoke and expire the refresh token that you use to do that. So if someone stole it, it will not be able to reuse it. And even better, if someone stole it before it has been used, then when you will use it, we will detect that someone or something, or there is an anomaly, and it will revoke anything that has been granted by these tokens and clear user sessions. So at the end, it will reduce the threat. So it's not bulletproof security, but it's a good compromise between end-user securities and end-user experience, sorry, and securities. So how do we implement it? Native supports in most of the middlewares and SDKs and so on. So again, just check documentation, check your authorization server, and you will find that you can use it basically natively. And sometimes we just forget that it exists and we start implementing workarounds there. Workarounds such as like, I don't know, not doing OAuth or doing some, don't know, shady things with APIs to try to hide something and get like access to. So no, just don't do it and use the standard for that. All right. Just some logistics. If you have some questions, there will be times after to exchange. But checking the times, if you have like really something, you can just ask or raise your hand, and I can get the questions, answer it if this is quick, or keep it for later. The next one, after talking about single page applications and the way they talk to API, is the machine to machine, right? Because in the best practices when we implement the frameworks, we have like many different canals to get API talk to each other. So most of the times it could be apps talking to API, but we have of course machine to machine. And this is the same story, right? It's a story about securely delivering access token, so we make sure everyone is happy. Delivering these tokens use well-known grant types called client credentials. Client credentials, it's perfect when you have like full machine-to-machine scenarios. So basically, an API can talk to an APIB. An APIB will as well have a client ID and speak to an APIC. The way it works is every API have a client ID and they are registered in my authorization server. So this way, they can always request tokens, get, I don't know, permissions, scope. As you see here, for instance, I get a scope to run a batch on APIB, and I get a scope to write like some audit trace on APIC. And what is important is, because each API has its identity, I can forge tokens that have the right scope for the right API and control what they can do. No, really apply access control and not just like a free access between API to anything. Nice, but what happens if we change a little bit the scenario and do human to machine to machine? So in this case, I have something like kind of hybrid. So at the beginning, it's kind of classical. I have an app. The application needs to talk to an API. Easy. She uses like authentication with like a node grant type to get a token. So user authenticate, I get a token on my app. The token is used by my app to access my APIB. And everything is fine. But then this APIB need at its turn to call another API to, I don't know, finish a transaction or finish something. So how does this API do? Normally, if we look at machine to machine, then the API has a client ID, call the authorization server, and get an access token to do that. But the problem here is that this access token will lose all user context. Because an API asks something on its own, not on behalf of a user. And the APIC need to know who was the user, who was the context, or claims, or any more information about the identity behind these transactions for traceability, for many reasons. So that's why the idea is to avoid using client credentials and find another solutions. So by the past, people have been creative and said that, yeah, it's fine, don't use client credentials, we're gonna just reuse the previous access token because he has, I don't know, like 15-minute expirations. I'm all good, APIB will reuse it to call APIC. And because they all trust the same authorization server, it's gonna work perfectly. Thing is, if you do that, you just bypass lot of security control. It works at the end, but it's really bad practices because you leave APIC open to many things because she basically don't check anything. The APIC will not check the scope, will not check that the token is for APIC and not for someone else, and just accept anything. So we should never do it. That's not a best practices. And for a long time, we were stuck here because there were no standards or no solution for that. So we were like trying to do something with headers and stuff. But now, there is a standard called O-Token Exchange. And O-Token Exchange, one of these purposes, because it has many, but that's the one I'm talking today, is to properly get a token for APIB to talk to APIC while keeping the user context from the initial request. The way it does is when it calls my authorization server to get a token, it will send the previous token with this request, meaning the token that contains all the user context. And the new token I will receive will keep all this user context so I can use it and call the APIC. So the conclusion is, if you face this kind of scenario, think about token exchange. Don't forget it, because that's the way to go. And the more we have API, the more it's spread everywhere, the more we run into this use case because of many microservices. So it's becoming like something very standard to do. Going forward, know that we got the tokens, we saw some scenarios about implementing the right standards, make everyone talk to everyone. There is a topic that we need to discuss is API Gateway. Why? Because we often have the question that API Gateway do API management most of the times. Solutions such as Okta, which are like customer identity and access solutions, do authorization server and do kind of API management in a way as well. So who does what? Do I need to integrate both? Is my API gateway enough? Because it can do all the jobs we are talking. The idea is that they are both complementary. Because API gateways, even if they implement like all the old standards, they don't have the same visibility on identity, roles, access. They don't have like the source and all the information that a customer identity and access management solutions can have to take decisions, right? And I say take decisions because API Gateway will still keep the roles to enforce these decisions, verify, and allow access to something. So when you have only one API gateways, yeah, the border is thin. You can still decide to use only your API gateway. But it starts to be more complicated when you start to have more API gateway because it's very common to see that I have, I don't know, APG, I have a Kong still deployed somewhere. I don't know, I use AWS as well. So then you end up with like many authorization servers, many solutions that do API management. And what you would like to have is one solution to rule them all. So you have a central decisions server, a central authorization server, and the API gateway to enforce the decisions. And you can do that by integrating with O2. So this way you remove the silo that you make by having like different environment, different API gateway, and you have a central view of what you do with your API. So that's the thing. Sorry for this very barbaric schema, but that's the way we deep dive as well in what we do through API, because we talk about tokens, API and so on, but what exactly we are doing and API gateway are doing. So I say like some summaries just before, but technically you have all the details here. In Okta, you can see everything we are able to check, control. So it can be from like authentications, risk-based authentications, better know the device used to access an app and so on an API before. So better comply with regulation as well. Build scope, build access token, be able to do extensibility, get extra entitlement, and so on. And then deliver this token to my app, as we saw on the top right, bottom right. And then deliver this token to my API gateway, so all the best practices to check this token is applied. And that's why another important feature is that API that were not born with like security in mind where they were developed because they don't support OAuth or whatever, they rely on API gateway to support that. And that's where as well the integrations make sense. being able to deliver auto access control and authorizations to API that are not made for. All right, so conclusion here is use API Gateway. Really, it's the best combination ever. Authorizations, server, and API Gateway are like, again, a classic, but this is something really to build at the beginning. Try to first integrate your authorization server with the API Gateway. Lot of buzzword here, zero trust. We talk about zero trust a lot as well when we talk about security, even for API, and we start to see that, how do I do zero trust on my API? How do I apply it? Where before it was more like, how do I do zero trust on my access to app, authentications, and so on? And we can picture it quite easily because it's all about authentications, access control, and so on. So what do I do to my API to, let's say, be not blind when I trust, but check a little bit more what's happening, so I implement more control on the API to be, let's say, a more zero trust compliant API. So by default, an API fully trusts the authorization server. As you see, you give like a nice and valid banana to an API, and she's happy and she's good to go. So the thing is, sometimes it may not be enough just to trust that my token is valid so I can give access to something. What I want is to have a little bit more than trust, a little bit more than just this signed token. Because for regulated environment, and there is many, could be like financials, no, could be like healthcare, things where you need to go deeper and further, you need to implement more things. These things you can implement in authorization server is proof and earn the trust the API give you by giving proof of authentication, proof of level of assurance, and sharing more than trust, because trust is not enough in this case. So authorization server will, in this case, add some information, for instance, about what authentication method has been used to authenticate the user in the beginning. So if my API is a financial API, I don't know, or regulated environment, it will validate the token and check that multi-factor authentication has been used previously. Because we need to think at, as API as autonomous system that need proof as well about things. And this can be shared because there is a standard called, and so this is the claim here, ACR. It's Authentication Context References. And this one can share what's happened on the authorization server. So again, it exists. You can use it if your authorization server supports it. And it's very like important information. And in the case it's not enough, let's say that here it's like only password, the API can return an error and say, I denied the access, please come back when you did MFA. So the app knows that it has to trigger a new authentication using strong factor authentication and so on. And the standards will allow it. With OAuth2, you can build a full transaction where you get an error from an API and trigger a re-authentication with like multi-factor, get a new token back, send it back to API, and the API will be happy. Other stuff we see as well is device context. This is coming really like more and more. Being able to check if you're accessing something from BOD, like any smartphone, or if we speak about like employee access to something, is it a managed device? And an API can require this information because an API will not return the same data or the same request if the API knows that it is managed or not. For instance, downloading or recuperating all the documents, the file, the data of something or folders may be denied if you are not on a managed device because we don't want company data to leak or to be stored or retrieved or on a non-managed device. And API can implement it directly. So, the role ID is to control and check the level of assurance. And this is a concept that we find like in many places, applications or API, checking the level of assurance to make sure that we are all compliant about what's happening and the requests happening on the API. And then adapt the response depending of what we receive on the request. So that's what you could do or you can do when you build API, let's say in a regulated environment when you need more than trust. If you want more reading, we're not going through all of this today because there is so many, but there is standards such as proof of processions, client-initiated back channel, all of this bring more security in the way you get tokens and you talk to API. One of the most emblematic one is the mutual TLS. So mutual TLS, you all know the concept. So we authenticate, the API authenticate a request, but we want as well to authenticate the API against, for instance, an application. So having mutual authentications between all the stakeholders. So we don't do it at the network layer here, but we can do it directly on an access token. And that's why we call certificate bound access token, because it had a new signatures that prove the identity of the app and prove as well the identity of the API both sides. And that brings as well stuff such as proof of possessions. So again, if you want to discuss more details, happy to discuss this later or after these presentations at the Okta booth. Last but least, I think this is our last topic, but it's a big one and an important one. It's all about authorizations. Because now we speak a lot about security of tokens, validations, access, and so on. But when we allow the access, what are the permissions? What can do a user? What can do an app on behalf of the users? All the permissions you can think about, like, do I have like rights on this folder? Can I validate the expense of Bob? Or all the things about permissions. Because it's kind of a headache, API and app and developers tend sometimes to think that authorization server is a magic solution that will handle this stuff as well. So know that we succeed at authenticating and controlling the access. Why not take this part as well? Why not just like store all the permissions on the authorization server? Because it's called authorization in a way. And then it will just like bring me on the plate all the information that I need. So I will have nothing to do on my API, no database, no requests, nothing. Mm-hmm. But this is a dream. And this is not something you can do because this is not the way authorization servers are designed, the auth authorization server. It has been designed just to downscale some limits or just to allow or I don't know, segregate some actions. The best example is when you authenticate on your mail server, let's say, and you authenticate with, an authorization server, it could be Google, let's say. So you authenticate on Google, and Google, when you access something with sign-in as Google, you have a consent. And the consent says, do you allow your mail server to access your profile, your mail, your photo, your contact? And you can give this access. And this is the scope. So basically, it's allowing an application to access all of your data, or only part of it. So this way, I can access an application to view only my name and not my pictures. So if we translate that in some more use case, that means an authorization server can restrict what can do an app, but it never set or define what the permissions are really for a user. It's not about managing the permission of a user. So in this case, if we do like a quick summary, I put like all the stakeholders, their roles and their responsibilities. So where we can expect things from an authorization server is authentications, access authorizations, and access limitations, which are scope. So we can limit what applications can do. All of that, you can have like an API relationships with your authorization server. That's fine. Authentication sometimes is much more part of the customer identity or the identity and access solutions, but more often the same platform. For the fine-grained authorization and permissions, the way to go, and we used to go, is the classic inline authorization, meaning that you have a database and you do requests on the database. End of the story. Or you use a third-party something, because you don't want to do it yourself anymore, and you want a tool to do it for you. And in this case, these tools will be an authorization service, if we use the vocabulary, precise vocabulary about the role. So I'm going to be quick, just give one example when you do like inline authorizations. If you ever develop APIs and do control, you can maybe understand this kind of situations. Because you have to check on the database what was the role, employee manager, and do conditions to do something. But you need to add a check for each role. Check all the cases that are possible. And then manage, okay, so he can do that, he can access this API, he can read mail, he can view this folder. So it's a lot of code, sometimes static code to do, and it's very like a headache. So sometimes we want to use the scope, as I say, which is not a good idea, but still, and we want to look at permissions here. That's fine, let's say I use the scope, as I know that Vincent has a document view. The thing with scope is that they only tell you an actions, like, okay, you can view documents, but it will never tell you what documents you can view with that. Because it always assumes that this is your data, your document. So it cannot be used as a real permission system. And of course, it's like many roles to create, and that's the problem of role-based access control. But I will not spend too much time on that. I will go straight for here. So what solution do we have apart from here? If you don't want to do inline authorizations, we need an authorization service. So the way we look at this as Okta, Okta.0, is we started to build a service that is called OpenFGA. And this service is built upon like Google Zanzibar white paper, best practices, and so on. And it works on relation-based access control, which is as well a good buzzword at this time. And the idea is really to set everything as a relations. So basically, my service here that you can call by API will be able to give you exactly the list of anything that a user can do on a specific resource very quickly with low latencies. And it will as well allow you to define authorization model very easily, the way you do with some framework already, kind of authorization model as a code where you can easily extend, add, modify it. And then you will be able to add like some tuples to it. If we look at how it works, I have like an example. So I will share the resources just after. So if we look at this, let's say, got the full tree here, type reviewer, and I will look for the expense, for instance, because we talked about expense just before. So the way it is that everything is stored as a relationships. So I have my expense, and I define how an employee is related to expense, what kind of role he will have. So here, and I will just zoom a little bit. Yeah. So here, I will define who can approve. I will define like the relations between a manager and employees. And when I've done that, I will create tuples. So basically, I will store data called my employee, donc employee type Matt, as a relation of manager to Daniel. So that's a tuples, just to define all of the relationships between users. And then I will have the relationships between users or group, if I define group, and the object, And the object, for instance, can be a report, can be an expense, with the specific ID of the expense. So what it means as well is that my application, my API, need constantly to write to my authorization service to synchronize all the new objects I create, all the new users. So anytime there is a new expenses, there is a new line that needs to be stored here. Anytime there is a new group, there is a new file, new object, new folders. So that means millions of requests sometimes need to be able to reach this authorization service to update the model and give response back. And that's the specificity of the service. It has been built to answer this million requests with low latencies, so it can be used very quickly by apps directly. So if I give an example of assertions, I want to know if, for instance, Matt can manage Daniel. I run the query here, and the query is a success. And basically, if I say employee Emily instead of Daniel, then I will run into like a failure. So basically, I can simply express in a very human language a syntax about, can this user do something with this relationship to this object, submit it to my API, get a true, get a false, and I'm good to go. So that's the relation-based architectures. And one of the benefits as well is that sometimes it's pretty hard to manage inheritance. And the fact that you have like nested folders or nested objects with many permissions set to many places, this model will automatically expand everything and give you all the effective permissions because it will take care of all the relationships when you do the query. And that's one of the benefits as well. If you want to learn more, the concept came from Google Zanzibar, so I strongly recommend this paper. And our implementation is called OpenFGA. You can access it on this website. It's an open source project, meaning that you can download it for yourself. It's a Docker container. Start using it. And if you need something more enterprise ready, we started as well to implement OpenFGA at Octaout Zero to host it on our cloud platform, run it, manage it, audit it, give SLA, and so on. For now, it's free to use because it's really a lab, a developer preview. So you can as well create free account, test it. And we hope that our first production availability will be soon. Something early next year. All right, that's documentation as well. And I promise you that some homework, if you want to know more or continue. This is basically a fine-grained authorizations lab that we share most of the times when we do like event, training. So if you got this URL, you will access like a Google Doc that will give you, let's say, like a self-learning path to OpenFGA, guide you to how to create your OpenFGA instance, create like an application to validate expense reports. Basically, it's going to be a Node.js app that you will be using and configuring to check how it works. Okay. Everyone, take the OpenFGA. I will conclude and leave it open for a few questions. In few words, we saw many things today, so it was dense. So thanks for attending and staying up on all this technical topic around OAuth. So in brief, don't overuse OAuth scope because there are not permissions. We just talk about it. Be careful of the OAuth grant type you choose. This is the first decision you have to take, and it is very important for security. Don't forget about token exchange when you do machine to machine, because we all do machine to machine and we kind of forget that it exists. If you're building single page apps with APIs, please use refresh tokens. There is security mechanism now. And if you want the best API relationships between authorization and API, it always includes API gateways at the end. So better start now. And of course, all of this, you can implement it with SDK. SDK, so is key component that guarantee the security, so choose them well. And that's very important. And then you can maybe have the chance to have the postal card and everyone will be happy. All right. Thank you for attending this session. If you have any questions. mic.
Hi. Hi. Thanks for the great talk. I've already been playing with the FGA that you've shown, and it's pretty powerful. But I have a question: if for some of the apps of a given company, they don't need this complexity, and an RBAC or an ABAC system is enough, can I model these permissions with this model that you've just shown?
Yeah, you can basically, because RBAC is just like a more limited relation in a way. Mm-hmm. So you have like a role, a user that is a member to a role, and a role that has like permissions or something. And you can completely modelize this in OpenFGA. It's going to be just a simpler model.
Okay. Thank you.
Thanks.
Yeah, thank you for the talk. Can you come back to the slide where with the diagram with the API gateway and all the services, please?
Yeah,
this one, perfect. Does that mean if we use the new grant you were talking about, like the exchange type, or so, I don't remember the name, does that mean our API gateway is also managing the traffic east-west? Or it's still north-south only, like on your diagram?
No, in this model, in my example, the API gateway is managing the traffic north-south, let's say, but the east-west traffic is managed by the authorization servers to allow an API hat to talk to an API B. If this is internal traffic, because in my example, we are kind of two APIs, you know, talking to each other. No, you can build a model where we always go through the API gateways, and the API's gateways then is just like you know, passing away the tokens, and just applying like security at the network level and other stuff to check for like malformed tokens and everything.